Hello, today we're here with Judith Wright alongside her new exhibition proposition, so grantpirrie, running through until the 16th of March. Welcome, Judith.
Thank you.
I think what would be great to start with is maybe talking us through the current show and how it sits within your body of work.
I think in some ways it's a radical departure in that the sculpture is something that I've never attempted before or even really thought about. But when I look back over the practice, the use of objects has always been a part of it. It's just that they've been found. I've felt a freedom in the form that I haven't before.
I mean, it's an amazing thing that you received that Australia Council Fellowship. I think that they're a great grant that gives you 2 years to research and really develop your practice. As a senior artist working in Australia, you've been practicing for quite a long time. I think the grant provides the freedom if you want to take that next step, and which I think the show really does reflect. Not only in working in a three-dimensional form with the sculptures made out of bronze, but the way the works on paper relate to the three-dimensional rather than relating traditionally to the video works that you used to make. You mentioned about this being a departure from the personal and being something more about the collective. Can you elaborate on that a little for us?
I think there are aspects of it that are entirely removed from it and other aspects that are absolutely a living progression. I was researching Plato and Pliny and their ideas of the birth of knowledge and the birth of art. And so that was one aspect of it, but on a personal level, the images, a lot of the images are quite closely aligned to things that I've done previously in my practice, and I used to make things out of plasticine when I was a child. So there's that, what I hope is a very direct engagement with materials that has a spontaneity and a childlike quality that I probably try to, a fundamental kind of position that I take, I think, with everything I do.
I mean, the sculptures definitely do have that art de pauvre feel, which is very much about sort of your hands being at play, how they have a very naive, if you like, the resolution of your aesthetic, which I think beautifully relates to the allegory of the cave, which is the Plato story that influenced you quite heavily in this show or in this work. But they could actually be objects that you would see in the reflection of that cave. And they're distorted, they're not literal. It's something that is kind of evolving and corporeal, if you like.
Sure.
I think also the choice to make them out of bronze is an interesting one, where bronze is traditionally a very esteemed medium for sculpture. You've kind of collapsed that boundary. Why did you choose bronze over something like clay or something else?
I think because I'm intrigued by the idea of using what's seen to be a for want of a better term, high art medium and bringing it down to something primitive and basic, and I also do that with the works on paper, I think, in that they're not works on canvas that are, it's not a negative thing, but it's an undercutting. That's just one aspect of it. The other is that I'm interested in the tactile, and the bronzes have a surface quality that aesthetically works for me, as does the paper. So they're married in my head anyway, in some way.
Well, I think they're married aesthetically very closely as well. When you see the installation of the sculptures alongside the works on paper, they have a very direct relationship. Even though the works on paper are abstract, you capture moments from the sculpture that's being reflected, if you like, in the mirror on the works on paper.
That's a direct reference to Plato. Also, I think with the sculptures, it's important for me not, again, not to have a representational image, that they can be read however the viewer chooses them to read, chooses to read them. So that engagement with the viewer and the viewer's imagination or memory or experience is fundamental, I think, to the making of work for me. It's not something that's dictatorial, it involves input from the viewer.
I think that's a very nice thing, and especially when you spoke about the works, you used to make works out of plasticine when you were a child. I think it speaks to that referencing memory, a childhood memory.
Yes, absolutely.
These stories that you've drawn from are allegories as much as they are myths. They're not actually, they haven't actually happened. They're kind of philosophical examinations of the world around us. And I think Camus spoke about it quite beautifully when he said that contemporary society isn't prepared for the disappointment that is coming, because we don't have an understanding of these stories. These classic stories, which were told quite heavily and taught quite heavily in schools. And I think one of the strengths of this exhibition is how you relate, you've shifted beyond the individual and your own personal experience, and capture that idea of the collective as well.
Sure. I think that one does what one does, but I've always been interested in the primitive, as opposed to the highly refined. I know that doesn't really answer your question. But from the beginning, those basic forms from antiquity, things that I'm excited by, and that continuum, you know, that absolute necessity of ancient peoples to make an image and to... So in some ways that addresses
And so there's that continuum of knowledge, I think, where one thing relates to another.
Yeah.
I was at the opening of the night, I was speaking to someone now. They were looking at one of the sculptural works and said, this looks like an Egyptian object that I have in my house.
Oh, wow, that's exciting.
That obviously you haven't seen.
Yeah.
But this work kind of references that, and it's like that continuum of knowledge moving forward.
And also how these things are interchangeable. I went to the exhibition of the Art Gallery of New South Wales yesterday, and there were images that, had you not been told that they were Chinese, they looked fantastic images. And there are these fundamental, iconic things that pass through, and that we need to acknowledge.
And I think that, you know, we as a society have this kind of striving forward in terms of technology as a definition of progress, but we often forget the history and what lessons that has to teach us. And, you know, I think this show is evident that, you know, history is still playing out, it's still very contemporary within the lives that we live.
Absolutely, and really to walk through that ancient exhibition is so confirming that it's...
And you're talking about the entombed warriors at the Art Gallery of New South Wales, which is an amazing tree cap of New South Wales.
Yes, and the artifacts. I was really referencing some of the artifacts that have absolutely Aztec. It looks like an Aztec imagery to me. Astonishing.
I think there's as much knowledge forgotten as there is known in our current a paradigm of existence.
Yeah.
And these things kind of help to remind us of that.
Exactly.
They're not the bearers of all knowledge and all things
in the world. Yes, yes. And more little progress in some areas we might not.
So does that
humbling?
Does this idea relate to the title of the show, Propositions? Is this
Yes. The propositions just stem from the fact that one reads what one chooses to read. That each work has several meanings or ways of interpreting it. And so that was its proposition. One can do with what one chooses to.
It all has its own story to
tell. Yeah.
This exhibition seems quite transitory. Not transitory, transitional before.
Yes.
Looking at your previous works, but you had a strong relationship to the video medium, yeah. Moving image. Where do you think that you're heading? Where do you think that this kind of supposes you're going to move to?
I think that over the 10 years I've made one particular range of videos. I've accumulated objects and mannequins to stand in for a personage, a particular event in my life, and a lot of those, I'm reworking those objects. I've always collected old instruments, and it will be some kind of orchestra or celebratory event. Mm-hmm. No silent. So, yes, so the instruments are silent, and the potential of silence is a little bit like the potential of the shadow. It has its own full memory, but it's not present. It's that presence and that dichotomy of presence and absence.
Okay, positive, negative.
Yes, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. I like how you're taking the moving image and nature of 3D. You're literally taking these objects that existed and had a life within your films and turning them into three-dimensional objects in a very literal way.
I'm really excited about the possibilities of it and the way it in some ways ties the whole practice together.
Mm.
One makes these things without really realising those sorts of implications until
it happens.
Yes.
Of course. Well, on that note, Judith, I think we'll leave it there. Thank you for talking to us today, and we look forward to seeing what you're working on in the future.
Thank you, Tim.